Belinda presents this unabridged recording of Volcanoes, a Beginner's Guide, written by Rosaly Lopes and read by James Adams. This book is dedicated to the explorer and adventurer Ralph B. White, 1941 to 2008. Chapter 1. What are volcanoes? What is your idea of a volcano? The image that probably comes to mind is a violent, angry mountain spewing out black clouds of ash and rivers of red-hot lava, burning villages and causing devastation and tragedy. We think of Vesuvius in ancient Roman times and its destruction of the libidinous Pompeii. We think of the eruption of Krakatoa in the 19th century and its catastrophic tsunami that took countless lives. Every now and then, the media focuses on a volcano that is, at the very least, worrying local people and sometimes playing downright havoc with their lives. In 2010, the Eyjafjallajökull volcano in Iceland demonstrated just how disruptive volcanic eruptions can be. Although its eruption was small compared to eruptions such as that of Pinatubo in 1991, its ash cloud, rising up to 9 kilometers high, blew over Europe, stopping air traffic for several days. Thousands of travelers were stranded, and the economic impact was felt worldwide. All these images are true some of the time, but in reality, volcanoes come with different shapes, sizes, and temperaments. It is fascinating to study what causes these differences and understand that, while some generalizations are possible, each volcano has its distinct quirks, just like people. We could also compare volcanoes to cats. With few exceptions, they spend most of their lives asleep. We will start our fascinating journey of understanding volcanoes on Earth, traveling from its beginnings to the evolution of its many cultures, with their diverse explanations of what volcanoes are and why they erupt. We will then travel on to the other planets of our solar system. Volcanoes are fundamental to the formation of planets, and many types exist, from the rampant, hot volcanic activity of Jupiter's moon Io to the cold, exotic cryovolcanism eruptions consisting mostly of liquid water from the interior of icy moons in the outer solar system. What exactly is a volcano? A volcano is an opening on the surface of a planet from which magma and/or magmatic gas emerges. Magma is molten rock containing dissolved gases and crystals. It originates in the mantle, which typically lies 80 to 100 kilometers below the planetary surface. When a volcano erupts, magma emerges in one or more forms: continuous lava flows, fragments varying in size from boulders to ash, or rapidly flowing currents of hot gas and rock fragments. The erupting lava and gases build up around the opening or vent to form the volcano. The landform created could be a field of lava, a cone, or eventually a mountain. Sometimes lava pours out onto the surface without explosions, and no built-up landform is discernible. You can walk for miles over the lava fields of the Krafla volcano in Iceland without climbing a mountain or even a sizable hill. Krafla's lavas pour out of great fissures, and the volcano is all around you. On other volcanoes, the exploded fragments of lava that land close to the vent build relatively small but steep-sided cones, such as the cones of Stromboli in the Aeolian Islands and Sunset Crater in Arizona, USA. The combination of lava flows and explosive eruptions over long periods builds the tallest volcanoes, such as Mount Fuji in Japan, a volcano that, for many, is the classic, with its convex upward shape and serene snow-capped summit. On Earth, the type and shape of a volcano is largely dependent on its tectonic setting, that is, where it is located relative to the tectonic plates. However, before we go into that, let's go back in time and history to remind ourselves how the inhabitants of many places and of many cultures coexisted with volcanoes and tried to understand their nature. Volcanoes and human history. People and volcanoes have a turbulent history. Mary Leakey's discovery in 1978 of hominid Australopithecus footprints some 3.7 million years old impressed on a volcanic ash deposit at Laetoli in Tanzania is a stunning example of how long this fragile coexistence has lasted. During and following an eruption, the effects of volcanic ash are devastating, but as the years pass, it contributes to the soil's fertility. People have long farmed the rich land on the slopes of dormant volcanoes, perhaps for many years, before a catastrophic event brought their towns, their farms, and even their lives to an unfortunate end. The earliest known tools made by humans were made from volcanic stone. Implements made from lava about 2.5 million years old were found at Lokalalei on the shores of Lake Turkana in northern Kenya. Obsidian, a black volcanic glass familiar to many of us, was prized in the Paleolithic Stone Age for its hardness, durability, and ability to split cleanly. It can be made into needle-sharp points and blades, including the familiar arrowheads. Our ancestors used volcanic pumice and ash to make cement. The ash, when mixed with lime, produces a durable, water-resistant cement that has been used since ancient Roman times. On a visit to the Greek volcanic island of Santorini, I learnt that pumice deposited by its Minoan eruption was used in the construction of the Suez Canal. Pumice quarries are still being worked in many parts of the world. Many of us have a piece of a volcano in our bathrooms. Another prized product of volcanoes is sulfur, once known as brimstone. Volcanoes are notoriously the embodiment of hell on earth. Sulfur burns with a strange, sputtering flame and produces the eye-stinging gas, sulfur dioxide, used to fumigate houses to kill insects or to bleach wool. Homer refers to sulfur being used this way. In ancient Greece, Egypt, and Rome, it was also believed to have medicinal purposes. Even today, in some volcanic spa areas, such as the island of Volcano in Italy, the dubious medicinal uses of volcanic mud and fumes are touted as curative. The warmongering Romans used a mixture containing sulfur as the first incendiary weapon, but not until the 13th century was sulfur's great potential in warfare discovered by the Chinese as a key ingredient in gunpowder. When the knowledge of gunpowder came to Europe in the early 14th century, its impact was huge. Knights in shining armor were no match for the explosive mixture, and the character of war changed forever. Centuries later, gunpowder helped take the Americas from their native tribes. When, in Mexico, Hernando Cortés found himself short of sulfur to make gunpowder, he sent some of his loyal soldiers into the crater of the active Popocatépetl volcano to collect some. The soldiers were successful, even though the volcano exploded during their mission. Volcanoes also yield more traditional riches. Diamonds and gold are found in the eroded roots of ancient volcanoes, but in some places, volcanoes are precious because they make life better or even possible. From the fertile slopes of Vesuvius, where grapes have been cultivated for centuries, to geothermal heat sources in Iceland, volcanoes have a profound influence on our lives and culture. While it is true that volcanoes can kill, the death toll from volcanic eruptions is usually low compared to that from other natural disasters like floods, hurricanes, and earthquakes. As our knowledge of how volcanoes work increases, We are increasingly able to predict when a particular volcano is likely to erupt. To the people living in the shadow of an active volcano, this knowledge is invaluable. This is why, for many centuries, humans have attempted to answer the most important question in volcanology: why do volcanoes erupt? Myth and history. While some explained volcanic fury in the terms they understood best, gods and goddesses, others attempted to put forward scientific explanations for the fire from within the earth. The first interpretations we know of are from the ancient Greek philosophers. In the 5th century BCE, Anaxagoras proposed that volcanic eruptions were caused by great winds within the earth blowing through narrow passages. He explained the melting of rocks as being caused by friction of these winds buffeting against rocks in the passages. This explanation, later adopted by Aristotle, was remarkably long-lived, surviving in one form or another until the Middle Ages. In ancient Rome, the philosopher Seneca proposed an alternative explanation, that volcanoes were giant furnaces in which coal, bitumen, and sulfur were burning. This view survived for many centuries. Hephaestus and Vulcan. People living alongside volcanoes have attempted to explain the rumblings, shaking, and fiery eruptions in many ways. To the Greeks, the god of fire, Hephaestus, called Vulcan by the Romans, lived beneath Etna in Sicily. Working beside his helpers, the terrifying single-eyed giant Cyclops, Hephaestus hammered on his anvil, forging thunderbolts for Jupiter. Other legends set Hephaestus's forge beneath the island of Volcano in the Aeolian archipelago, which gave its name to all volcanoes. In the 17th century, the French scientist and mathematician René Descartes proposed that the Earth had been a star and volcanic eruptions were caused by the intense heat still trapped within our planet. In the 18th century, basaltic rocks were accepted as having been created by ancient volcanic eruptions, resulting in the recognition of ancient volcanic rocks from various places around the world. Historically, this was the victory of the Plutonists, who held that rocks were formed in volcanic eruptions, over the Neptunists, who believed that rocks formed from the crystallization of minerals in the early Earth's oceans. Thus, igneous petrology, the study of the melting and crystallization of volcanic rocks, began in earnest. In the 19th century, volcanology made a significant leap forward when the pioneering geophysicists George Powlett Scrope and William Hopkins discovered that rocks melt without addition of heat if they move upwards towards the Earth's surface where the pressure is lower. Hence, there was no need for a furnace or other heat to melt the rocks. However, what made rocks move upwards? An explanation had been proposed in the 18th century by Count Rumford, who suggested that there were convective currents within the earth. These large-scale, very slow currents can move rocks up, which then, as Scrope and Hopkins's findings explained, melt because of the decrease in pressure. In the early 20th century, the heat source driving these currents was discovered to be caused by the radioactive decay of certain elements within the earth. The early part of the 20th century also saw the work of Arthur Holmes, who brought together these ideas and laid the foundation for the theory of plate tectonics. Since then, we have made ever greater advances, but volcanology still presents many questions. Although we have come a long way from the days of appeasing the gods, we still have much to learn about what makes volcanoes erupt. Where are volcanoes found? Active volcanoes are found on every one of the Earth's continents, even Antarctica. About 600 continental volcanoes are considered active, meaning that they have erupted within the last 10,000 years, but there are many more under the sea. The majority of the Earth's volcanoes are submarine, although many people have heard little about these underwater volcanoes, probably because when they erupt, they kill only fish. History and journalists tend to favour human catastrophes. Whether they are underwater or on land, volcanoes don't randomly pop up here or there. The location of volcanoes is controlled by plate tectonics. With rare exceptions, the Earth's volcanoes sprout at plate boundaries, concentrated in narrow chains that follow the boundaries, where over 94% of historic eruptions have occurred. It is not a coincidence that most earthquakes occur along the same boundaries, where the Earth's plates are spreading apart, the mid-oceanic ridges, or being pushed together, subduction zones.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.